you for joining the webinar today. My name is Amanda Jadro, and I'm a portfolio analyst with Tricom Funding. As a solutions provider to the staffing and consulting industry, it is our philosophy to be an active member in the staffing industry by staying abreast of the ever-changing marketplace. For then, Tricom was pleased to launch the Industry Insider webinar series designed to share our expert knowledge and resources with our fellow staffing industry colleagues. One of our values is to build relationships and become a leading resource to staffing and consulting firms nationwide. Our guest is Alan Gilbert. Alan is a business development executive with Essential StaffCARE, a division of Insurance Applications Group, LLC. Alan is responsible for business development of Essential StaffCARE's fixed MSP plans to staffing firms throughout the U.S. Alan also serves as AIG's liaison for several state staffing associations and corporate partners. And dozens of presentations to different groups regarding the impact of ACA on the staffing industry, and truly enjoys being an ACA matter expert resource for his clients and prospects. And over 25 years of experience in the professional services field, including several years in the staffing industry. He holds a double major in business administration and in economic securities for the City of South Carolina, and is a South Carolina licensed life and health agent. Members in the staffing industry breathe a sigh of relief when the IRS delayed the employer responsibility provision until 2015. That has released final regulations, which allow employers to make some critical decisions in the months ahead. In today's webinar, our guest speaker, Alan, will share some information on ACA strategies to reduce your staffing firm's tax implications, including the minimum essential coverage date, a future ACA, a year ACA strategy, and ACA analytics and reporting. And you should have the information you need to prepare your staffing firm for the impending implementation of the employer mandate. If you have any questions during the presentation, please utilize the chat feature located on the right toolbar. There will be time for your questions at the end. And there will also be time for a poll to give us your feedback on today's presentation and any other future topics that you may be interested in. With that, I will turn the floor over to Alan.
Thank you, Amanda. I first want to start by thanking everyone for taking time out of what I know are busy schedules to attend today's webinar. As I pointed out, we do a lot of these. We don't profess to have all the answers, but I think we have a firm understanding of the options that are available to staffing firms. That's where we're going to spend most of our time today. I'm not going to go back and spend a lot of time on some of the, you know, ACA 101s, if you will, but I'm going to go through some slides. And I guess the first thing that we have to get disclosed is the fact that we're licensed insurance professionals. We're not tax advisors, we're not lawyers, we are insurance sales folks. I think we have a pretty darn good understanding of how this law is going to impact our clients and prospects, but the fact still remains that you need to consult with your own legal counsel and tax advisors as to how your participation in this program could in fact impact your firm. Many of you, I'm sure, have attended previous Essential StaffCARE webinars, and we thank you for that. The webinars are still available on our website. On the main page in the upper right-hand corner, there's a healthcare reform tab. If you click on that, it'll take you to recordings of all the previous sessions we've done. I don't know if I'd recommend going back to one or two, but certainly if you need some refreshers on the look back and what constitutes a variable hour employee and so forth, listening to 3, 4, and 5 might be of benefit to you. Today's agenda, as Amanda pointed out, we're really going to focus most of our attention on strategy. I was fortunate last week to spend a few days in Washington, D.C. at the American Staffing Association Annual Law Conference. And certainly, it gives me a face-to-face opportunity to talk with folks that are in your shoes, discuss the kind of challenges that they face and talk through in very real terms what some of these strategies might mean in terms of options for them. So I'll give you just a brief, very brief overview, and these slides I'm sure will be made available. Is that correct, Amanda, that you will be able to forward this presentation to others at the end?
Yes, I can do that.
Okay, perfect. So, you know, we're the leading provider of healthcare benefits to the staffing industry. We have over 1,000 staffing companies implemented in our fixed indemnity product. As this slide depicts, we've been fortunate to be recognized. I think the one thing that we're most proud of is our the Inc. 5,000 fastest growing companies, and to be able to do that year after year after year is quite a feat, I think. So as to where our client concentration is located today, and from there, let's go on to really the basic play or pay strategy in at a glance. Of course, slide does need some, this was a standard slide until some changes recently occurred, but if you're a large employer, and that definition, of course, now has changed for 2015, for your large employer, if you have greater than 100 full-time employees on payroll, if you're a large employer, on December 31st, 2014, you will be a large employer for the entire year of 2015. And of course, the converse is also true. If you're less than 100 full-time employees on payroll on January or December 31st, 2014, you will be a small employer for the entire year of 2015. So regardless of what happens during the year, it's a one-year designation, if you will. The choices essentially are pretty simple. You can either offer an MEC or a minimal essential coverage product. If you choose not to offer something, you're going to pay a $2,000 penalty assessed at $166 a month on all full-time employees minus the first 80. That also has changed from 30 to 80, so I want you to make note of that. Of course, the option would be to offer a MEC, a minimal essential coverage plan, to all of those full-time employees. Then the question becomes, does this plan meet minimum value? Is it affordable? If it doesn't meet those, it could trigger a B penalty. We'll get a lot more into that discussion, but essentially, if you don't offer a minimum value plan or if it's not affordable, you leave yourself susceptible to someone going to the exchange, receiving a subsidy, and that would essentially trigger the B penalty or the $250 a month for a collected penalty of $3,000 for the year. If you offer a minimum value plan that is in fact affordable, by merely offering that plan, you would have no penalty at all. The challenge comes that those plans are, their availability of those plans for staffing companies are relatively tight right now. There's a couple things that occurred recently. The recent delay that came out announcing that insurance plans that do not meet the ACA requirements can continue to be offered for an unspecified period of time. That was something that ironically was thrown out, I think, in the last month or two, just before a midterm election. But the problem with that is just because the administration says these plans can be sold, it is ultimately up to the insurance commissioners in the various states. And most of those commissioners have opted not to allow non-compliant ACA plans to be continued to be sold. There was some, as I mentioned earlier, the full-time employer calculation moved from 50 or more to 100 or more. That was one recent change. In that initial law, it said that you had to make a offering to 95% of those eligible employees. That has been delayed now until 2016. For 2015, you'll need to offer a minimal essential coverage plan to at least 70% of your full-time eligible employees. So there was a little bit of relaxation, if you will, in the compliance requirements there. The break in service rule also got changed. Originally, that break in service rule basically says that if you have an employee on payroll and you are you know, look back rule on those employees. Previously, it said that if the employee was absent from your workforce for 26 weeks, you could essentially restart the clock, if you will. The rule has now been reset to 13 weeks, but that only applies for those employees that you're hiring in 2015. And so if they missed 13 weeks, you could essentially reset the clock on the look-back rule. You know, one of the greatest challenges I think that staffing companies are going to have is not so much identifying the ongoing employees, the ones that are currently on payroll in 2014. I think it's going to be very easy for you, most of you, to identify which employees are in fact qualified as full-time employees, and thus you would have to provide a offering of a minimal essential coverage product. I think that's easy for the ongoing. I think the challenge is going to be in 2015 when you're hiring new employees, and the law very specifically says that at time of hire, you must make a determination at that time whether this person is in fact a variable or a non-variable hour employee. The look-back rule can only be applied to variable hour employees. So there are some additional clarification in February of this year that provided some additional guidance around you know, this idea of who's variable, who's non-variable. In my opinion, that continues to be somewhat nebulous and very difficult, I think, for most staffing companies to identify. I could also, Amanda, provide a slide presentation that was provided by ASA, specifically gives some examples of examples that the IRS has given that may very well make those kind of determinations a lot easier. So I will also include that in what I what you could potentially send out to attendees of our webinar today.
Fantastic. Thank you.
Yeah, and you know, one thing to read a guidance or a sentence that says something. Well, I'll go back here. In that recent analysis or guidance, it talks about, they gave four examples that could help you determine if someone is a non-variable hour or variable hour. I've read it probably 25 times, and I still, they don't go into the extent of the detail that I would like. For instance, they tell you that all four must be met. They don't say that three of the four must be met. So they leave it very open. So, for instance, some of the litmus tests they give is, does the employee have the right to reject an assignment? Well, I would think everybody could pretty much feel most of their employees have the right to reject an assignment, so you could kind of check that one off. Are there going to be periods where no offer for a placement is made? Yeah, I think, you know, that you could probably check that one off. Are placements for different periods of time? Now you're starting to, you know, depend if you're hiring for a specific client. So that gets a little, you know, has it typically offered placements that do not extend beyond 13 weeks? This 13-week period seems to be kind of a length of time. If something's less than 13 weeks, it's probably variable hour. If it's in greater than 13-week periods, maybe it's, you know, you have less of a argument saying that person's variable hour. But the law very specifically states, and this is where I would allow this to guide my decision. It's a great deal about facts and circumstances regarding the assignment. For instance, if you're assigning Johnny to the XYZ company, facts and circumstances associated with the last 200 placements you've made at the XYZ company, that those people go to work and they work 40 hours or plus a week, and they work for some undetermined period of time, I think the facts and circumstances surrounding that assignment would be difficult for you to defend that that's in fact variable. It doesn't appear to be variable. It appears to be a non-variable hour. So, I think there's certainly going to be some additional guidance in this area, but I just wanted to point that out. But in examples I will give to Amanda, I think it's one thing to see a sentence, but it's yet another when the IRS actually issues something that says, you know, here's some examples. So I'll make sure that she gets that for distribution. I'm going to switch gears a little bit because this is where I want most of our conversation to be today, is around the subject of strategy And before we really can get into strategy, we really got to talk about, you know, get some basic terms defined. The law says that you must offer minimal essential coverage to your employees in order to get over the A penalty. And again, you would only have to make this offering to your qualified full-time employees. A minimal essential coverage, that term, really describes more about where the employee is getting coverage, and means a great deal less as it relates to level of coverage is being provided. So don't think about minimal essential coverage necessarily as being a certain type of plan, but rather it's where they're getting their plan from, and what they're specifically referencing are employer-sponsored ERISA-qualified plans. So the purpose for the purposes of tax, minimal essential coverage means any group employer plan, health plan, except, and you can see all those things that are listed as exceptions. So anything that's offered as a group insurance plan with the exception of accident policies, long-term care, dental, vision, fixed indemnity products, all of those plans are referred to as accepted plans. So those plans are specifically excluded from ACA. They don't meet the guidelines. They're purposefully accepted. What you don't see as one of the accepted benefits in that list is in preventive plans. So we're going to come back to that in just a few minutes. Minimum value determines whether an employee actually gets a subsidy or not. And minimum value plans are not to be confused with minimal essential coverage. Minimal value plans specifically refer to plans that have 60% actuarial value, and that's an insurance measure on the amount of benefits that are paid by the plan. The easier way to interpret in your mind what a minimum value plan is, think about those plans as being the bronze plans that are being offered through the exchanges. The plans are, in fact, those plans that meet the bare minimum 60% actuarial value. And it's whether an employer offers a minimum value plan or not, that ultimately will determine if someone, one of your employees, can, in fact, get a subsidy through the exchange. So we'll talk a little bit more about that. We'll talk a bit about the idea of what's affordable when the law says that a minimum value plan must be also, it needs to be 60% actuarial value, and it also must be affordable to your employees. And that, by definition, is their contribution, the employee's contribution, cannot exceed 9.5% of their W-2 wages. So these are some of the basic guidelines that we'll use as we consider some of these other concepts. Now, a year ago, 16 months or so ago, we learned of this concept. I don't know if I can necessarily track back where it originated, but some really really smart ERISA attorneys and people that were very familiar with existing ERISA law began making comparisons between existing ERISA laws and the new ACA, and they'd be connecting dots and making some inferences. And what they concluded was a wellness and preventive plan is considered a group, employee health plan under ERISA laws. There were some, maybe this does rise to the level of minimal essential coverage. Our concern initially was that it certainly didn't appear to meet the spirit of the law. But I think we all agreed that, the law and what it was intended to be saying was that employers needed to provide a quote, major medical minimum value plan, but nevertheless, we remained skeptical for a number of months, and then after getting some additional confirmation from Ed Lenz and Alden Bianchi with the American Staffing Association, talking with our own legal counsel, we concluded that, this does appear to rise to the level of minimal essential coverage, these wellness and preventive plans. So as I continue to spell this strategy out, I do want to point out that HHS, Health and Human Services, while we requested for clarification. And verbally, they will say, yeah, that certainly appears to be a plan that would satisfy this, the requirement of MEC. They have failed to put that in writing. So, while everyone, I think, agrees that this strategy could work, how long it will work, I don't know. But it appears that it will be a workable strategy, at least for 2015. So StaffCARE, as well as other companies, have created these plans. These plans tend to be self-funded in order to avoid any state mandates, because what these wellness and preventive plans are doing is they're addressing a very specific list of 63 federally mandated wellness and preventive benefits. And they're broken into three different groups, adults, women, and children. So there's very specific screen, counseling type of benefits that are all centered around this concept of wellness. But please keep in mind, these plans are just that, screening, counseling, that essentially provide little or nothing in the way of treatment of an illness once it's been identified. But it does provide things like contraception, mammograms, various kinds of cholesterol screening, all these kinds of screening and other type of wellness measurements, if you will. Let's move on to the next slide. Examples of some of these wellness plans I talked a little bit about just a moment ago, but in 2015, the concept is that a wellness and preventive plan is expected to eliminate the $2,000 A penalty on all full-time employees by simply offering a wellness and preventive plan. By offering a wellness and preventive plan to your full-time employees on payroll, by merely offering it, you would be avoiding the $2,000 penalty on all full-time employees. However, because these plans do not rise to the level of minimum value with major medical insurance plans I described earlier, what it does is it leaves the potential or possibility of one of your full-time employees, in fact, going to a state or federal exchange, applying for a qualified plan, and if, in fact, they obtain a subsidy, trigger what's called the B penalty, which is a $3,000 penalty back to you, assessed at a rate of $250 per month. So, while you're over the A penalty, the $2,000 on all full-time, it does leave you potentially susceptible to someone going to exchange, receiving a subsidy, triggering the B penalty. No employer will be assessed the B penalty if an employee does not receive a federal subsidy. So before we leave the screen, I wanted to just introduce the concept of, let's say you had an employee that's a relatively low-wage employee that, in fact, desired to go and get a ACA-compliant plan through either a federal or state exchange. Through the process of qualifying for that program, if they meet certain guidelines, they may very well could be identified as being eligible for Medicaid, at which point they would be redirected to Medicaid. And if it were to occur, there would not be a $3,000 penalty because the employee would not have ever received a federal subsidy, but rather they would have been redirected to Medicaid for coverage. So getting redirected to Medicaid does not trigger the $3,000 penalty. So as each of you are thinking about your mix of employees on your payroll and whether in a state that has expanded Medicaid or not expanded Medicaid, these are the kinds of considerations that you need to take into account when you're trying to assess what kind of exposure there really is to you. So with that, having concerns about wellness plans, again, the one thing that we're really straightforward with our clients about is while this appears to be a workable strategy and one that could quite be one of the most cost-effective strategies for our clients, it's certainly not without some concerns. There's this concept about, this actuarial certification. We feel comfortable that that the plans that we have developed, and I'm sure that those that others that have designed these plans have gone through the necessary steps to ensure that they are actuarially certified as wellness and preventive plans. So, but obviously you'd want to make sure that whoever you're buying this product from, that they've you know, crossed their T's and dotted their I's. The other concern is, could this be a short-lived solution? Well, as I mentioned earlier, we've had a difficult time getting anything in writing directly from HHS, Treasury, or IRS, but verbally they will state, yes, those plans do appear to satisfy, and I can see where you guys arrive at that. But again, this could be a short-lived strategy. We feel confident that it's going to be good for 15, but how much beyond that, I can't say. I think we have a couple things that are at work that are working in our favor. I think that the midterm elections later this year will be the reason why not a great deal of additional changes will be made to ACA, because the administration certainly doesn't want any other new backlash, if you will, from ACA to impact the midterms. And when we get beyond the midterms, of course, you know, whether we or not, I think the majority of 15 and 16 are going to be clearly focused on the next presidential race. The question then becomes is, you know, they really want to kill a strategy like this that could potentially impact thousands of business owners in the segment of industry of staffing if they were to do away with this strategy. So, you know, more to come, where we certainly will advise people as we learn. As I mentioned, the self-funded plans, the reason why these wellness plans are self-funded is to avoid individual state mandates. Because they are self-funded ERISA plans, they only have to adhere to federally mandated benefits. So it, by having it self-funded, it avoids the state. I talked a little bit about that. Underwriting administrative issues. It's okay for full-time. It's questionable for part-time. Do you really want to offer a benefit plan that is going to be, by the way, these are monthly premiums or attachment points. You refer to attachment points when you're talking self-funded, but the fact is these are not going to be like your fixed indemnity products that you're familiar with today that have weekly payroll deductions. These are going to be monthly list bill plans. So you would clearly want to focus the offering of these kinds of plans to your full-time employees and not your part-time, because of the potential billing reconciliation, and if somebody only works 3 of the 4 weeks, how's it going to work? So I would just limit this to your full-time, because really those are the ones that by offering it, you're going to be achieving this essentially tax strategy that we talked about. Going forward, you can offer these things, these plans, these wellness and preventive plans. We are offering it one of two different ways. I can't speak to how all companies in this industry are offering these plans, but we are offering these plans to our clients as one of two different ways. You can offer these minimal essential wellness and preventive plans as a voluntary plan. What voluntary means by definition is that an employee, if they want it, they voluntarily purchase it, and they pay for it. But let's talk about if you offered a wellness and preventive plan on a voluntary strategy, what are the implications? Well, you can rest assured that you will have relatively low enrollment. By default, you would also then have relatively high exposure to the B tax. Would be cost to the employer. There's the good news. You could offer this as a voluntary plan at no cost to you. Low value, because again, I mentioned these plans pay for a very specific list of benefits. It costs roughly $65 to $70 a month, depending on a couple different factors, census data, whether you want stop loss coverage included. It covers pain and prevention. As I mentioned, there's really no essential health care benefits like treatment, doctor visits, in-hospital stay. None of that is covered in these wellness plans. It requires very extensive disclosure, because there's going to be there's going to be some impact on employees that, in fact, enroll in these plans. HHS could clarify this option away, if you will, leaving employers with a struggle to make any kind of change in strategy. But for right now, we feel fairly confident that this is a strategy that is workable for 2015. So before we leave this page, I want to just hit home two points. If you offer a wellness and preventive plan as a voluntary plan, you're going to have relatively low enrollment and high exposure to B, but there would be no cost to you. Okay. That in mind, I want to switch now to another strategy that you might consider, and that is offering the plan as an employer-paid benefit. If you were to offer this plan as an employer-paid benefit, that means that you would be paying the monthly premium, and offering this as an employer-paid benefit to those full-time qualified employees that are on your payroll. If you would do that, I think we could all agree that you would have relatively high enrollment, because generally speaking, people don't turn down stuff that's free. We would have a very clear disclosure that talks about, as an employee of the XYZ company and a full-time and qualified employee, your employer has chosen to offer you a minimal essential coverage wellness and preventive plan. By you accepting this plan, you would be satisfying your individual mandate requirement. So you would, in fact, be helping your employees to avoid their individual tax penalties. So that's a positive. One of the things that I want to really make sure that everyone clearly understands, that as long as someone is enrolled in a MEC plan, the employee cannot receive a subsidy. So if you enroll an employee, if you offer this as an employer-paid benefit, you could expect high enrollment. You would expect, therefore, you would have lower exposure to the B penalty, because as long as an employee is enrolled in the MEC plan, the employee cannot receive a subsidy. Now, the employee could, in fact, opt out of this benefit offering at the time of offering. So when you rolled this out to your full-time employees and explained to them what the plan does and what it doesn't do and what it covers and what it doesn't cover, through very clear disclosure, they would have the choice to say, I don't want this. So opt out at the time of offering, as they could disenroll in a year. In cases, because they would no longer be, or in the case of opting out at the time of offering, they would have never enrolled, or they would be free to go to the exchange, apply for an exchange qualified plan, and potentially receive a subsidy. But as long as they are enrolled in the MEC plan, they cannot receive a subsidy. So I'm going to leave just for a second to kind of let you think about that, because there's a subtlety there for between offering this plan voluntarily, where you'd have low enrollment and high exposure to B, but if you offer it as an employer-paid plan, you should expect to have higher enrollment, even with the substantial disclosure comments would have to be made. If high enrollment, you should have low exposure, lower for sure, exposure to the B penalty, because as long as someone's enrolled, they can't receive a subsidy. So they, therefore, by definition, they can't trigger a B. These premiums or these attachment points would be tax-deductible business expense. Again, roughly $70 a month. Cover screen, as I mentioned, could clarify away. We'll keep you posted. But, there's the subtle difference between how an employer can choose to implement a preventive plan, if it's voluntarily or employer paid. As I understand it, there are some companies out there that are not offering these plans on a voluntary basis, but rather as only an employer-paid benefit. So just keep that in mind. So leaving the wellness and preventive strategy, we can certainly come back to that and answer any questions you might have, but a thorough discussion of your options would not complete if we also didn't talk about another strategy. And potential, there's a number of reasons why I use that word. But minimum value plan. These value plans, again, as I mentioned earlier, think about them as being the bronze plans on the exchanges. Clearly what HHS meant with regards to a target or a target floor of benefits. The law, I think the spirit of the law was that employers should be required to offer a minimum value plan. And it was only this, quote, loophole, if you will, that was discovered that brought about this wellness and preventive strategy. But minimum value MAC plans, cover 60% of the average population's medical claims, that's that 60% actuarial plan I mentioned to you, or that evaluation concept. It gets the employer over the MB penalty as long as you're offering a minimum value plan and it is affordable to your employees. And again, the affordability test only has to apply to the individual plan that you offer to your employee. You do not have to make, quote, the offering of coverage affordable to his dependents. It only has to be affordable to your employee, and that affordability test, again, is he or she, your employee, cannot contribute greater than 9.5% of their wages in the way of an employee contribution to this plan. So if you offered a 60% actuarial plan and made it affordable to your employees, you would essentially be getting past both the A and the B penalty without question. Okay? There's some downfalls to this. By offering affordable minimum value plan, an employee and family member will not be able to receive subsidies. It's called the family glitch, and that is very clear in the law. If your employee takes your minimum value plan or not, accepts it, declines it, it doesn't matter. If offering a minimum value plan and making it affordable, the employee nor their family members would be able to receive a subsidy through the exchange. I've posed that to clients and prospects I've talked about. I get mixed reactions. Some reactions are, I don't care. I'm just following the law. Okay, well, true. It says if you offer a minimum value plan and make it affordable, you've done what you have to do. You complied with the law. The problem is, are you really doing a disservice to your employee? And what I mean by that is, if you have relatively low-wage employees, who better to benefit from a new program like this than low-wage employees that could, in fact, go to the exchange and would clearly qualify for federal subsidy? But by offering this plan, this minimum value affordable plan, you have essentially barred your employees and their family members from these subsidies. And why might say, I don't care, that may be different. Your opinion of that may be different if Johnny finds his way to the 7 o'clock news and he's standing outside of one of your clients talking to an investigative reporter from Channel News Denver and says, you know, I work for the XYZ company and those rascals, they're offering me a minimum value plan that they know that I can't afford. And you know, by doing that, my family and see my wife here, my two little kids, we can't get a subsidy from the federal government. And that would happen. But I certainly wouldn't want it to happen outside of my staffing company. Just something to think about. But let's get to the real life issue here. Insurance companies are not scrambling; they're beating each other over the head to try to get to offering minimum value plans to this industry called the staffing industry. And they're not doing so for a number of very, very good reasons. And the main reason I'm going to focus on it is the conversation that I've had 100 times if I've had it once. I talk to a staffing company owner and I say, well, let me ask you, what would you like? What's your perfect solution here? And well, here's what I want you to do. get us a fully insured major medical minimum value plan. I want you to make it affordable to my employees and offer it. I'm going to hope nobody will take it. Let's sit for a second, and then I say to myself, and then ultimately to the person who just made the comment, I say, you have precisely identified why the insurance industry is not rushing to find solutions. Because what you said was you want them to expend energy, resources, designing plans that when they're offered the buy that plan, hopes no one will buy it. Why does an insurance company do that? Why does a company develop a plan that the person they're intending to sell it through, i.e. through the staffing company to their employees, is hopes that no one will take it? So I understand why the overall, but I can point to three distinct reasons why insurance companies are not scrambling to enter an industry that they have historically not underwritten, and three major aspects of the law. The very first one is group health insurance as of January 1st, 2014, there are no more annual nor lifetime limits on claims. The sky's the limit. Where insurance plans used to have annual limits, the insurance company would pay up to X, and then after that they would stop paying. The limits are gone. Insurance companies are on the hook for every single claim that comes in, whether it comes in 1 year or the lifetime of the policy. There's no limit to exposure to liability. Well, let's get in for a second. And then on top of that, they said you had certain participation requirements. In order to have a group health insurance plan, if you had 100 eligible employees under the old rules, a carrier might say, in order for this to be a valid plan, I have to have 75% participation. And that participation, while an unknown person looking at that might say, well, gee, that seems unrealistic. It's not, because it's the only insurance companies were able to spread the risk associated with sick people versus healthy people. By having good participation, they were able to distribute that risk. The requirements of participation have been taken out. Insurance companies can no longer require a certain level of participation. And then third, and is just as hard-hitting, there's an aspect of the law that says that a group health insurance plan must pay out 85% of premiums collected in claims, and it's 85% loss ratio. Insurance companies must pay 85 cents of every dollar they take in claims. If they do not spend 85 cents on claims of every dollar, they have to refund whatever they don't spend, fund to the insured. Leave the remaining 15% to run their businesses, IT, marketing, administration, salaries, bonuses, commissions. 15% is what's left. Wow, that's tough. Let's hope the insurance or hope the government never steps into staffing companies and says, hey, whole industry as of January 1st, 2015 must operate on a X profit margin. Let's hope that never happens. So obviously quoting has become a very, very difficult thing for insurance companies to run industry they have historically not ever written before. Are some plans out there available? Yes, there are. They tend to be plans that are designed for very large populations. We have a partner that will allow us to offer fully insured plans to staffing companies, but they have 3,000 people on payroll. The business rules become daunting for a lot of companies. There are all funded minimum value plans out there. Continue to work on the idea of offering a self-funded minimum value plan. And there's a lot of issues regarding major medical self-funding for the reasons I just talked about, not to mention just the unlimited claims exposure. Even with stop-loss coverage, which you wouldn't want a self-funded major medical plan without stop-loss coverage. Even that would only cover you to a certain point, and once your claims flew through that, if they did, you would be on the financial hook for that. We had some recent conversations with our friends at Blue Cross Blue Shield of South Carolina, and beginning of this year, that's a very interesting point to think about. They're receiving $1 million-plus claims at an unprecedented rate, like never seen before. It all has to do with the healthcare providers in America know that insurance companies must pay the claims. So, one okay with the sun still shining. So, we sense our partners at Blue Cross, we've heard the same thing from Blue Cross Blue Shield of Georgia. Insurance companies are getting claims at a rate that exceed $1 million at a rate they have never seen before. And it's because, I think, healthcare providers recognize they can bill whatever they basically feel like billing. To give you my idea of what these minimum value plan, I want to save some. I'm not going to go into this, but I think everybody knows that these plans are going to have high deductibles. They're going to have high out-of-pocket expenses. There's going to be large co-payments because they're percent value by definition. And that, the only way you can get to a 60% actuarial value plan is to have a plan that doesn't cover some of the benefits. So there's going to be significant out-of-pocket exposure on these plans. Structures, insurance companies are now looking at quoting industries that previously have been on decline list, that's the staffing industry. New structures include no minimum participation requirements. I talked to you about that. Reasons why underwriting concerns, there's no claims history, don't know who enroll. There's the list goes on and on. There's insurance companies are not racing to offer minimum value plans to the staffing industry. They're just not. This actually shows you how, depending upon the state you're in, the poverty level, what the earnings are, what the penalties are for 14. This doesn't include because they do go up in 15. But what the penalty would be for someone making $16,755 would be $168. The average plan cost is, that if they went through the exchange, got a subsidy, their cost would be somewhere around, $627 government subsidy would kick in about $3,335. So you can see how these plans are being heavily subsidized. Let's talk about where we think it's going from now, from here. We highly unlikely this bill is going to be repealed or replaced with a new law or new regulations. Certainly no likelihood of any changes between now and the midterms. Will we potentially see something in 15? I guess anything's possible at this point. Likely, there will be an eventual replacement of private health insurance to a single-payer system or version of it. Most likely, the bill will continue to be amended or fixed, so employers will continue to scramble to comply. The compliance burden of these of this will provide more employers to opt out and simply pay the tax. There was a study done on 500 companies, and a study was done that said that if the Fortune 500 companies in America opted out of offering major medical, they could save in excess of $700 billion in the next 10 years. A lot of money. And more and more companies around this country, in our opinion, will be analyzing the escalation of their premiums and simply saying, no mas. I'm going to get out of this. I'm going to figure out if I have a $2,000 penalty if I don't offer a benefit plan to my employees and I'm currently spending $9,000 per employee on benefits, it doesn't take a rocket scientist or a CPA to determine that it's best for them to opt out. Now, what they do to soften that blow of their employees being going to the exchanges, I think there's a number of strategies employers might take to soften that blow, if you will, allowing employees employees to, okay, we're longer going to offer a major medical plan. You're going to get your catastrophic care through the exchanges. Oh, by the way, as an employer benefit, we're going to pay for an increased shift to defined contribution plans. That's where we think the industry, it stays on its current path today, more employers would opt out. That having been said, you got to ask yourself this question. Employers in America who have historically offered major medical insurance to their employees are considering opting out. Would an employer in an industry that has never offered major medical plans consider to jump in? Why a staffing company offer a minimum value plan? Those who have historically offered it are considering getting out. Just something to think about. So with that in mind, I'll leave some time. A couple things we want to keep an eye on. The audit rule, you know, we're keeping an eye on that for you. It's something that if it ever got enforced, it would be a kick, a hard one, to not just this industry, a lot of industries. So we're keeping a close eye on that, the auto enroll. I'm not going to go into this because I think everybody knows that plan specs are important. The real important factor when you're considering a plan to do business with or what company is understand what they've done in the staffing industry. And how have they successfully administered plans that are currently being used in this industry? Because let's face it, administering health insurance plans for the staffing industry are a great deal different than it to a traditional workforce that doesn't have 400% turnover. So administration is the key, not plan design. Your strategy, track your employees, make sure that you have ways in place to make sure that you're identifying eligible employees when, in fact, they're eligible. There are software systems out there that are doing a great job. Make sure you're tracking your employees. Make sure you're closely watching it. Make sure you have partners that can help you determine the best strategy for a pay or play. And here is the outline of the CA and Health and Human Services. I always love that slot because it's so it there's all these unintended consequences. And that's it.
Okay, so we have now opened the floor for questions. So go ahead and use the Q&A feature, the chat feature, and your questions. We have one question that has come in already. Okay. Is there an 80% cutout for 2015 on the tax also, or is the penalty charged from the first person who receives the subsidy?
Yeah, it's, there's. I think there's a couple things being asked here. The 80%, it's not actually 80%. It's the hard number 80. So in the past, what the law said was if you chose to opt out, and if you decide to simply pay the penalty, you're going to offer an ACA-compliant plan. You're going to pay the penalty. In the past, it was you got the first 30 employees for free, and you paid the $2,000 penalty on the balance. What new provision, the recent change, was that that number moved from 30 to 80. It's 90%. It's 80. It's 100. You have to have 100 full-time for this law to even apply to you. So let's say that you had 125 full-time employees. If you choose to do nothing, you're going to take 125 minus 80 and pay a penalty on 45 employees. I hope that question.
Can I answer the question regarding the B tax? So mm-hmm. offered a plan mm-hmm. and decided not to take that plan and they went for the subsidy, you would be potentially eligible for the B tax on that employee who went to the subsidy?
That actually received one, that is correct. You it would trigger the B penalty, the $3,000 penalty, yes.
And then every single person who received the subsidy?
That's correct.
Okay.
But here's one thing to note. This is very important. The B penalty can never exceed what the A would have been. If you had 200 employees, and you were going to pay a penalty of $2,000 on each. You have a $4,000. You know, that's the limit that you would have to pay. If you no action, you would have number of federal tax penalties. The B penalty can never accumulate to exceed what the A would have been.
Okay. Another question: is there a minimum number of employees for law to apply?
You, an employer, in order for the law to even apply to an employer, must be defined as a large employer, and by definition, they must have in excess of 100 full-time employees on their payroll. And there's a very specific formula that tells you how to do that. It's contained in many of our webinars of the past. What I could do, Amanda, is I can include the slide from previous presentations that shows how to apply that formula. Determine if you're a large and small employer.
Great. Does 9.5% limit apply to gross wages, and does it apply only for coverage offered to the employee only?
Very good question, and it's yes to both. Yes, it applies to gross wages. And again, the law, when it was written, it said that an employee could not pay greater than 9.5% of their household wages. How in the world can an employer know what Johnny's household wages are? It's the most ridiculous thing I've ever heard. So they created a safe harbor, and they said, okay, all right, fine. You can use this. You can determine affordability on the individual's W-2 wages, and the affordability test only has to apply to individual coverage.
Okay.
So that offers answers. That question.
I think so. Now, if the headcount is below 100 on December 31st, 2014, I escape ACA penalties. I not need to account for temps that worked for short periods of time during 2014 but are no longer working for me?
No. If you do the large employer test, and that's the is a formula that's different than the look back. There's a very specific formula to determine if you a large or small employer. If you apply that formula to your payroll and you conclude that you are under 100 full-time employees, you will be under 100 full-time employees for the entire year of 2015. I would suggest that if you go through and you apply this formula and you determine that you are less than 100 full-time employees, I would suggest pouring yourself a big glass of wine and enjoy.
Sounds good.
That's what you do, but that's not maybe the way everybody rolls. But you only get tested once. If you're deemed to be a small employer, you're a small employer for the next 12 months. If you're deemed to be a large employer and you lost half your business in February, you would still be considered a large employer for the remainder of 2015 regardless. So there's a positive and a negative edge to that one-time test or annual test, if you will.
Every year you should reassess if you're at that 100 or more?
Absolutely, absolutely. And in most of the software systems out there today, as I understand it, many of them have not only the tracking of employees, but also this calculation to determine if you, in fact, are. You could run your ACA tracking report, if you will, on many of these software systems. And in the case of Tricom, you guys are you guys have that feature to determine someone as a full-time employee. You're tracking that.
Right. Okay. Would the current plan that our employees purchase through you guys still fall under the definition of not a MEC plan? Is the plan now acceptable to 2015?
It is clearly not. It is not an MEC plan. It is not an ACA compliant plan. But seemingly enough, the plan that we offer is being considered a record rate. And a lot of that has to do with it delivers great value. I mean, it's first dollar coverage, no deductibles, no co-payments. You know, there's a lot of benefits to it, so I won't go down that road. But the most important thing, and this is where we see the growth, not only just of our plan, but fixed indemnity products in general. Employees are going to go to these exchanges. They're going to buy the least expensive plan because that's what people do. And in the process of buying the least expensive bronze plan, they're going to have the highest out-of-pocket expenses associated with any of the plans. So Ronnie realizes that while he has great catastrophic coverage, he's still going to be responsible the first $5,000 of out-of-pocket expenses. He's going to look to an indemnity product to help him use as a gap product to cover those out-of-pocket expenses. That's going to be the trend, no question about it. Because I've often said, if you make $9 an hour and you have a $5,000 deductible, it might be $5 million. You're going to have
$5,000. And is there research where they can find the formula to qualify as a large employer?
Absolutely.
And that was the slide that you were going to provide to me?
I can provide that to you, but those of you who are ASA members, they're on their healthcare white papers. They cover this very extensively, but I can, Amanda, provide you with the slide that covers that formula. It's actually very, very simple.
And okay.
I won't burden you with it right now, but it's very simple to apply.
Yeah, great. And then I will email it out to all of the attendees today so that you have that for reference.
Perfect. Perfect. Any other questions out there? Do we still want to answer them while we're as a group that others could benefit from the answers?
Anything else that has come in at the moment? Do you have any other final comments or thoughts that would be helpful to share with the audience today?
We have had some great questions, and I appreciate it. And again, I appreciate the opportunity to, in wrap-up, we profess to have all the answers. I don't know if there is such a thing as a perfect solution, but we're really working diligently to help our clients avoid or minimize the tax penalties associated with this law. Those who do not have relationships with insurance professionals, and particularly those that have experience in the staffing industry, we'd welcome that opportunity. I guess that's
right.
It.
Great. I've put the contact information up on your screen. Alan is a great resource. Essential Staff Care is a great resource for information on ACA. Certainly feel free to reach out to them if you have additional questions or looking for more information that would be specific to your needs. Mm-hmm. I will follow up today's presentation with an email to everyone. I'll attach the for you guys to look at, as well as the additional handouts that Alan will be providing to us.
When you're doing that, I want everybody just to keep in mind, I'm getting married this weekend, so I'm going to be enjoying a out-of-country honeymoon, and so I'll be out of pocket for a few days. So, while you send me emails between now and the 9th of June, you will be directed to one of my colleagues for assistance.
Thank you for sharing that with us. I hope you have a fantastic wedding and honeymoon.
Yeah, thank you.
Great. So, again, with that, I did put up a poll, so please give us your feedback. It's very helpful to us. I'd like to really thank everyone for their participation in today's webinar, as well as all the questions that came in today. And certainly, Alan, for sharing your vein of knowledge on the ACA topic. We'll have a recording of today's presentation available on our website for future reference if you wanted to hear it again or share it with others. If you have any questions, you can reach out to myself or Alan, and we'd be happy to get back to you with that. Look for more information on our next webinar session, which will be held on June 26th, and it is regarding social science, a social media webinar. So with that, I hope you guys have a fantastic afternoon, and we look forward to talking with you soon.
Thank you.
Thank you.